Hundreds of students apply for the FRQNT scholarship every year, and I was one of the only 8 applicants who got the scholarship last year in the category Nature and Technology. In today's video, I will share my application documents with you and show you exactly how you can get this scholarship too. Hi, my name is Sadia and I am a PhD student at École de Technologie Supérieure, Canada. I have received more scholarships in my life than I could have ever imagined. I have never paid a penny for my education, and on this channel, I share how I keep getting all these scholarships. Alright, so let's get into it. There are 2 ways you can apply for this scholarship: through your university or by yourself. If you're applying through your institute, keep an eye on your university's emails because they will let you know when the competition is open, and the university will do an internal selection before they forward your application to FRQNT. If you're applying by yourself, which is how I did it, you don't need to wait for your university. Just keep an eye on FRQNT website. When the competition is open, you can apply by yourself. Here is a list of documents you need to apply for this scholarship. The first 3 documents are like essays that you will write and you will prepare by yourself to convince them to give you this scholarship, basically. The other documents, you might already have them on you, like transcripts or your common CV and other stuff. The first document basically is the justification of application and interest in research. This is the one in which you show your justification of your application, in which you convince them to give you this scholarship and you show how interested you are in your research. The second document is just the description of your research project, and that's more technical one. That's the one in which you explain your MS or PhD project, your thesis, your research topic, and the related backgrounds, your milestones. There are specific questions that you need to answer in that particular document, and that one takes a lot of time to prepare as well. The last document that you need to prepare is the achievements document, and that's the most tricky one, I think. If you don't have a lot of awards and achievements on your profile, then that one is gonna take a lot of time to prepare. You're gonna have to dig deeper in your internships, projects, course projects to show some achievements and awards on your profile. So this one is gonna take a bit. So I think out of the first 3 documents, the second one would be the most difficult to prepare, but the first one and the third one would be more tricky to think about, you know, to basically think about what to write in. So yeah, I'll show you mine in a bit. The other documents are pretty standard. If you don't have a Canadian Common CV, I would highly suggest you to make one right now. Even if you're not applying for this particular scholarship, still go to Canadian Common CV website. Prepare a CV for yourself, because you'll never know for how many scholarships, for how many jobs you will need this CV. The others are just transcripts, and in your transcripts, usually on the backside, the grading system is shown. If it's not shown, you need to request your university for a document that shows the grading system that was applied to create your CGPA or your grades or whatever. Also, you need your proof of registration, so that goes without saying, because this scholarship is for existing students who are already studying, doing a master's or a PhD at a university in Quebec. So you need proof of your registration at your university. Usually your university will charge you like $5 to $10 to prepare this document for you through registrar's office, and you can just get it from your university within a couple of days. Let's go to my computer and see how I prepared each of these documents. The first document you need is justification of application and research interest in research. In this document, you see that I'm starting with the words "my broader research interest is." So right away from the first sentence, it tells you what's my research about. Then I'm also using some techniques like making the text bold to grab the attention and show exactly what my research area is. The bold text that you see in my application is: develop state-of-the-art machine learning approaches to solve the challenges associated with massive connectivity in future IoT networks, which is my PhD research area. So you need to tell them right away at first glance what's your research about, why are you interested in doing that. A tip that I would give you is never start writing before reading their questions. So when you get your when you start your application, you will look at the questions they ask you for each document. My tip would be to make a list. Read those instructions at least 4 to 5 times, and every time you read them, make a list of the questions they want answered in these documents. You should have a concrete list. You should know what exactly they want to highlight. If they ask you why are you interested in it, if they ask you to demonstrate your research potential, if they ask you to show how you became interested in this particular field, write those questions down, make a list, and then make it very, very obvious in your document that you're answering those questions. A general tip that I use is starting each paragraph by answering one of those questions. So if they have a question related to what's your research area, I start a paragraph by my research area is. If they ask a question, how did you become interested in this particular research area, I start a paragraph by the way I became interested or why I became interested in this area. So, you know, you see at the beginning of each paragraph or in the form of bullet points or in the form of bold text, you need to show them exactly that you have answered all of their questions related to this particular document. So if you take a look in my second paragraph, I'm starting with, in post-COVID-19, organizations will take full advantage of smart factories, workspaces as they revisit design strategies to blah, 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 blah. So I show the importance of my work, why this work is important, why in post-COVID era it will become even more important. Then the next paragraph I start with, the variety of activities I'm engaged in my current research range from. Now this is again from one of the questions they asked, what are the activities you are engaged in related to this particular research area? So I start my sentence exactly by answering the question that, okay, these are the activities related to this particular research that I'm engaged in with my research group. Again, there was another question about how did you develop an interest in this particular research area, and I relate it. In the very next paragraph, I show, I was teaching EE361 communications theory to undergraduate electrical engineers when I developed an interest in solving radio resource allocation problems. So I relate, what was I doing? Why was I doing it? How is it related to the problem that I'm working on right now? And how did I develop interest in this particular problem? Same goes for the next one. For example, here, when I say, when it comes to machine learning research for wireless communication, there is often a large gap between theory and practical implementation. So you see, again, this answers a question that they asked. The complete document is full of the answers to the questions they asked, nothing more. You have very limited space and you're very restricted in the format in which they allow you to submit your documents. There is a specific font size, there is a limit on number of characters and words that you can use to explain what you're doing. So you have to use each and every sentence and each and every word very, very carefully. I will share this document somewhere on my website and I'll link it maybe in the description or somewhere. You will be able to find this document to download and reuse if you want, and you can see how I structured every paragraph. You can match it with the questions that they asked. So you don't need to read everything on your screen right now. But the important point for you to note is that never ever miss any of the questions asked in your documents. Moving on to the second document, description of the research project. Now in this document, you need to answer specific questions again. So if you see, I'm starting directly with a heading called issues. So here I'm explaining what are the issues in my research field and how I'm trying to solve them. I'm using some references to highlight the importance that these issues are there and other people are trying to solve this problem, and I'm not the only one who has invented a problem to do a PhD in. It is a real problem out there. Other people are trying to solve it, and that's why this is an important problem to solve. Again, notice the beginning and ending of each paragraph. I started with issues, that the number of IoT devices is expected to reach 41.2 billion devices. So I'm highlighting the importance, why this problem is very, very important. Then I explain the concept of cognitive radio emerged as a promising solution. So this gives them a little bit of background, what's cognitive radio. Then I mentioned the current state of the art in cognitive radio algorithms. So I mentioned that, okay, this is the definition, this is what cognitive radio is, and this is a little bit of background, what it's about, why is it a problem, and how others are trying to solve it. Then I mentioned specifically the vision of this project is, and notice the change in the font here a little bit. I mentioned it in italics because this again answers one of their questions. What's the vision of this project? So I start this paragraph by answering the question, and I highlighted that this is an answer to the question they asked. The vision of this project is blah, blah, blah. And then I mention the vision for this project. After that, I am mentioning the research objectives. I'm highlighting them by making lists, bullets, headings, objective one, objective two, objective three. I'm writing my methodology, which they asked specifically. And in the methodology, the very, very important thing is to break down your methodology, your project, into phase one, phase two, task two, task three, task four, a number of tasks, a number of phases. And then that way, when you're making your Gantt chart, when you're making your project timeline, which I made here, you don't have to use a lot of space. You can just specifically reference them. This is phase one, this is phase two, this is phase three, phase four, and these are the each of the tasks for each particular phase, and this is the timeline in which I'm trying to accomplish them. So that makes it obvious that you have a clear game plan, that you know what you're doing, that you have some clear cut milestones planned for your project. So yeah, that's very important to highlight. They also ask for contribution. So you show how this project will contribute to the advancement of knowledge in your particular field. You don't just want to be doing research for the sake of research. You need to be contributing something concrete to the field of study in your field. So this particular paragraph shows exactly that. And then these are the references that I used in this particular project. And notice I cited my own papers here. So this is another subtle way of showing that you have certain background in this field and you've been working on this project. Even though my paper was not 100% directly related, I still used it to show that, okay, this is, I know what I'm doing. I have some background in it and I have published research in some quality journals in this particular field. So if you have some previous works that you can cite, don't feel shy to cite them. It actually adds value to your project. Here's the trickiest of all documents, experience and achievements. And these are your work-related achievements. They don't care about your non-academic achievements here. So you start with your publications. You list all the journal and conference publications and you highlight your name in bold to show at a glance what was your contribution for the paper. Were you the first author, second author, or the last author? You list your journals, and if the journal is an impact factor journal and the impact factor is available, you also list the impact factor. Then you have to elaborate on each of those journals. So that's your research contribution. For each journal paper, first, the first line of your explanation should explain what the paper was about. So you will start with something like, in this paper, we presented this novel algorithm that does this and this and that. After explaining that only in one sentence, because remember, you have a very limited space. Next, you will explain what was your personal contribution for this particular paper. So you will use sentences like, I proposed an algorithm, or I conducted the simulations, or I derived the mathematical model for the paper, or I created the illustrations for the documentation of this paper, or I documented the results and findings, I validated the results. So this specific contribution, exactly what you did for the paper, you will list it down in two or three sentences maximum, and that way you will explain all of your previous research papers, what was the paper about and what was your specific contribution for that paper. The second section here is participation in research projects and training courses. So here you will list all of your related experiences, your internships, your projects, your jobs that are related to your current research. If you did, I don't know, babysitting for someone, that's not relevant experience for this particular research grant, so you won't list that. You will only list something that is relevant to this grant. So you will list your research experiences mainly, and here again, you will describe specifically what you did in that particular role which relates to this particular research grant, or how you gained experience that is relevant to this particular research grant right now. After listing all of your works, always finish with a concluding paragraph. So in my concluding paragraph, I explain, these research experiences built a strong foundation for my PhD and motivated me to continue working in the area of radio resource management. So basically, I'm explaining that all of these research experiences that I have listed have led me to where I am, and these have built a strong foundation for my research, for what I'm doing right now. They have led me to be here and conduct my research and do what I'm doing and why I'm doing this. So basically, you have to bring it home in the end. You list your experiences, you list your papers, you list your achievements, and in the end, you conclude that all these have pointed me in this direction, and now I am doing what I'm doing because of all that I listed in this document. So here's a quick summary of how to prepare your document for this research grant. Read the descriptions 3 to 5 times. Make lists of questions that you need to answer in each document. Start each paragraph by answering those questions and making it obvious. And use a lot of bullets, headings, Gantt charts, anything that can make your document easy to read and obvious to follow. Let me know if these tips helped you. If they helped you, please share with others, because I'm a big believer in sharing with others whatever I learn, whatever I get in life. So if you learned something from this video, please share with others who might be applying for this scholarship. If you would like to use my application documents as a sample, you can go to my website academiccoaching.ml, and in the section shop, you can find all these documents there for a very small price. You can download them, use them as a sample, but please don't plagiarize, because if you plagiarize, you are decreasing your own chances for getting this scholarship. Use these documents only as an inspiration to follow the format, to see how I answered these questions, but please don't plagiarize anything for your own sake. All right, last but not the least, the amount of the scholarship. The amount of the scholarship is $21,000 Canadian, and the scholarship is paid 3 times per year in the installments of $7,000 per installment to you. The installments are paid at the beginning of the semester, so if you need to pay for your health insurance per semester or your tuition fee per semester, you're in good hands. The schedule is pretty good. The stipend is also subject to some special circumstances. For example, during COVID, they allowed the COVID special grants, so you could request additional funding if you lost your internship, if you couldn't do a summer job, you could ask for additional amounts. The same applies if you need extra time to finish your master's or PhD. So if your 4 years or 3 years or whatever the length of your program is has passed and you still haven't finished and you need additional funding to continue your studies beyond that, there are conditions that allow you to request additional funding for that. And this applies to a lot of other circumstances like child support and some other special conditions for which you can request additional funding. So the money is quite good. In case you're new to the channel, welcome to the channel. Don't forget to subscribe. You might want to turn the notification bell on in case there is a new scholarship open and I make a video about how to apply for it, so you will get the notification in your inbox. I don't know where you get YouTube notifications, but you'll get a notification somewhere.